In this last section of chapter 5, I'm going to talk a little bit about other acellular infectious agents. I am going to be very brief about them, mainly because they're quite rare. We don't see a lot of them, but I do want you to be aware that they're out there. So these are other types of infectious particles, basically. They're not cells. They are, however, infectious agents, and they are responsible for certain types of disease. Probably one of the best examples of these are prions. Prions are infectious proteins, basically a misfolded protein that infects other proteins, turning them into more misfolded proteins. This one's pretty dangerous. The most common result of a prion infection is what we call a spongiform encephalopathy, okay? Basically, where the prion begins to degrade brain tissue, and what we see is that formerly very dense brain tissue, sorry about that, is that formerly very dense brain tissue actually now begins to have holes in it where the prion itself has begun to degrade the tissue. The most common human version of this is something called Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease, specifically infecting the nervous system. It causes gradual degeneration of mental faculties and eventual death. As of right now, there is no cure, and I will be the first to admit that prions are extremely difficult to get rid of. Very honestly, our method for dealing with prions is avoidance. We attempt to make sure that infections just don't happen. Okay. The one most people are familiar with is bovine spongiform encephalopathy, or BSE, commonly known as mad cow disease, that is also caused by a prion. There has been a recent crisis in Europe, where researchers found that humans could actually contract the disease by consuming contaminated beef. The issue with that is that cooking the beef does not get rid of the prion. Prions are extremely resilient. To be very frank, they're harder to kill than bacteria. Infected individuals developed a variant of Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease, and just to give you an idea of how widespread the European crisis was, as of 2011, the United States has only seen 3 BSE positive cows. Okay, compared to over 184,000 BSE infected cows in the United Kingdom. Okay, so England was dealing with this, and Europe was dealing with this much more than the US was. So again, if you want to talk about what a prion looks like, they're composed entirely of protein, no nucleic acid involved, no DNA, no RNA. It's basically a misfolded protein. We still have a lot of questions about how prions are passed from person to person, what they actually do inside of the cell. For the most part, what we can see is that prions that are misfolded have a tendency to misfold other prions, and that's really a lot of what we know at this point. Now, there are virus-like agents that very specifically parasitize plants. These are what we call viroids. They specifically target plants, and most commonly we see these being an issue for crop plants. So economically important crop plants, tomatoes, cucumbers, chrysanthemums, citrus trees, potatoes. If you ever see your tomatoes in your garden go bad, with these little spots on them, these are areas of viroid infection. Okay. Mums, okay. We see an issue with mums. These are naked strands of RNA. These are basically infectious RNA particles. They're not coated with a protein. It's RNA passed from one plant to another. Now, the last part I want to talk about here is treatment of viral infections. One thing I want everyone to remember for the rest of their lives is that antibiotics have no effect on viruses. If you have a cold, if you have the flu, an antibiotic will not help you. Okay. Antiviral drugs are specific to viruses, and the way they work is that they block some aspect of viral replication. Well, if you remember, viral replication, especially in a human, had six very specific portions. So the antiviral has to sort of eliminate or block one of those parts of the virus. We also see interferons being used. Interferons naturally occur in human cells. We've actually had some success in extracting interferons or replicating interferons and using them as antiviral treatments. To be honest, our best bets here are avoidance and immunization. Okay? Vaccines are geared towards basically training the immune system against a virus, building those memory immune system responses that will very quickly help get rid of a virus. Okay? Now, viral vaccines come in three types. Active vaccines, which in which case people are given usually a very low dose, okay, of what we consider live viruses. And those viruses have somehow been attenuated or grown in a culture that doesn't necessarily allow them to affect human cells. But there is the possibility that you could get sick from a live virus. Every semester I have someone tell me they got sick from a flu shot. The flu shot is an inactive vaccine. In other words, if you're going to use those live and dead terms, which you know we don't like, it's a dead vaccine. You cannot get the flu from a flu shot. Now, the nasal mist that they're giving out, especially if you're in the military or if you have children, the nasal mist is an active vaccine. It seems to have a slightly better possibility of building an immune system response. We also see subunit vaccines, which are basically pieces of viruses. Chopped up, so you only get some of the capsid components or some of the spikes. All of these are there to pretty much train your immune system on how to deal with a virus. Some examples of this, and our three main modes of action or mechanisms of action, and if you look, I stole this from chapter 10, okay? Inhibiting virus entry, basically protecting the cell from the virus getting in. There are several of these. Probably the most common one for you guys that you've seen out on the market is Tamiflu. Now, if you have been given Tamiflu, chances are you have been told that it is either going to work and work quickly or it's not going to work at all. That's because it prevents viruses from getting into cells. If you wait until you are very sick with the flu, the Tamiflu will not do anything for you more than likely because the virus is already in your cells. So it's one of those reasons why during flu season, if you feel sick and really do think there's a possibility that you're coming down with the flu, you know you've had contact with someone with the flu, go get your Tamiflu early. It will work. I've seen it happen. Inhibition of nucleic acid synthesis. We see these doing things like being antiretrovirals. So they break down or inhibit viral enzymes that are responsible for helping to make new viral components. Okay? So if we need new viral DNA or new viral RNA, inhibiting those polymerases or transcriptases, it works really well. Okay? Or drugs that inhibit viral assembly or release. Okay? One thing you'll notice if you start reading over here, again, the bonus here is that if the virus can't get out of the cell complete, it can't infect new cells. One thing you'll notice is that HIV drugs are going to be found in every single one of these categories. That's really been a big part of HIV triple cocktails, is that they're going to give you something that hits the virus from all sides. An entry inhibitor, a synthesis inhibitor, and a release inhibitor, in order to try to keep that virus in check. So this ends the chapter 5 lecture. Okay. Watch the videos a couple of times. Keep at it. Go over those replication cycles. Make sure you can list those steps in replication and what's happening in replication. And make sure you have all of your terminology down. Okay.